make something out of the chaos of existence.
The war had other profound effects on the history of modern art. It forced artists fleeing the war in Europe across the Atlantic. New York became a magnet for exiled painters and sculptors. Young American artists were now able to see works by painters like the Russian artist Chagall and the surrealist Max Ernst at first hand. Among them was a reclusive country boy from the plains of the Midwest, Jackson Pollock, who had moved to New York at the age of 18 to become an artist. But Pollock was among a handful of painters who, although inspired by the foreign masters, wanted to break away from the European tradition.
There was a sense that if art was going to be made in New York, it was going to be made anew, which was a perfect setting for a sort of modernist eruption, almost, in painting.
Pollock began to experiment. His work became more abstract, his paintings more expressive. But it was in 1943 that he produced his most startling work, a vast canvas called Mural. It was unlike any style of painting ever seen before in America. A mass of wild brushstrokes, which seemed to take on no recognizable form. On seeing Mural, the renowned American critic Clement Greenberg hailed Pollock as the greatest painter this country has produced. Despite Greenberg's praise, Pollock was still unknown outside the small American art clique. It was when Pollock and his wife, Lee Krasner, moved to Long Island, outside New York, that he was able to fully develop his unique style. This documentary, which Pollock narrated, is one of the few surviving records of the artist on film.
I hardly ever stretch my canvas before painting. I prefer to tack the unstretched canvas to the hard wall or the floor. On the floor, I'm more at ease. I feel nearer, more part of the painting. Since this way, I can walk around it, work from the four sides, and literally be in the painting. I continue to get further away from the usual painter's tools, such as easel, palette, brushes. I prefer sticks, trowels, knives, and dripping fluid paint.
Pollock had tremendous amount of excess energy. When you think of Jackson, you know, his eyes were like burning vortexes. And the energy in this man, you know, he was wired. So think of him tuning into the wiring system of the universe, which is, we are all connected now. And think of his work that way.
When Pollock exhibited these new so-called drip paintings for the first time, the art world, or at least some of it, was transfixed. In a rare surviving interview, Pollock spoke about the inspiration behind his new style.
Mr. Pollock, there's been a great deal of controversy and a great many comments have been made regarding your method of painting. Is there something you'd like to tell us about that?
My feeling is that new needs need new techniques. It seems to me that the modern painter cannot express this age, the airplane, the atom bomb, the radio, in the old forms of the Renaissance or of any other past culture.
I suppose every time you're approached by a layman, they ask you how they should look at a Pollock painting or any other modern painting.
I think they should not look for, but look passively and try to receive what the painting has to offer and not bring a subject matter or preconceived idea of what they're to be looking for.
It's an astonishing experience to stand in front of a great Pollock. It's like being able to capture the Milky Way and the capillary in somebody's eye at the same moment. And I find that thrilling, to be confronted with a Pollock that does that, that has this incredible space through it. And you're an active participant in the painting, because your eyes are literally making the painting as you're looking at it, and you follow these balletic movements.
Pollock was at the forefront of a revolutionary group of artists known as the Abstract Expressionists. Inspired by the Surrealist principle of painting by free association, these artists wanted to produce expressionistic and spontaneous reactions to the world around them. But with this newfound success came an increased demand for his work, which Pollock struggled to cope with. He became ever more reclusive. At the age of 44, he died in a car accident after a heavy bout of drinking. America in the 1950s was turning into a land of plenty. Wartime austerity was now a thing of the past. People were eager to spend, and advertisers ready to help. Televisions, cars, washing machines, toasters, everyone wanted a piece of the new modern lifestyle. But the first person to spot the artistic potential of this consumer revolution was not American, but British. In 1956, this picture began a new chapter in the story of 20th century art. Its catchy title, Just What Is It That Makes Today's Homes So Different, So Appealing, hinted at a new humour and irony in art. The artist was Richard Hamilton, the 34-year-old son of a lorry driver from South London.
Hamilton wasn't just important for British art, Hamilton was important for art, full stop. I mean, this is one of the giants of 20th century art, who for some reason has been sort of strangely underestimated. But if you think that the discovery of the modern world as a suitable subject for art, if you think that what pop art went on to do, which is essentially say, hey, these are interesting things that are happening in the modern world, the commercial world, if you think that's an important discovery, and I do, because it gave art a future, then Hamilton's your man.
Richard Hamilton had received a classical training in art at the Royal Academy and the Slade before working as a designer in London. He became fascinated by the way the invasion of consumer goods was transforming 1950s Britain.
This absolute tidal wave of exciting cultural things was a really exciting moment. It was a really overwhelming moment. They hadn't really experienced anything like it before. And it was a revelation. It opened up everyone's eyes to this new world of possibilities.
Hamilton's collage is an ironic altarpiece to consumer culture, a hymn to an achingly desirable modern lifestyle. The vacuum cleaner with the extra long cord to reach that little bit further. Comic book page framed like a work of art. A supersized branded tin of ham. At the heart of the picture stands a bodybuilder holding an oversized lollipop labeled with the word pop. This image would thrust Hamilton to the forefront of a movement which became known as pop art. In 1969, Hamilton was interviewed at his home by Joan Bakewell for the BBC's Late Night Lineup.
Richard Hamilton, in 1957, you were doing work which was later to earn you the title of Father of English Pop Art. How do you feel about that now?
At the time, I was just doing something that was very necessary in my own terms. I was trying to make an art which was figurative in the midst of a lot of painting that was abstract, hard edge, abstract expressionism. The influence of America was very strong at that time in England. Suddenly there seemed a need to be concerned with the mass media. intellectually, but then wipe it away from one's interest in a studio seemed very odd, and it was a question of making some adjustment of these two separate fields of activity.
Well, he was tall and gangly with his hair all over the place, and he was very, very relaxed. He was very easy to be with. He lived in a modern home, which was all full of rather eccentric things. I remember there were helium balloons on the ceiling, as I recall, and there was a work by Dieter Roth, which he explained to me was made of porridge in polythene, which I found rather bewildering.
At what point did you begin to use these mass media, Hollywood movies, photographs, advertising, in your painting?
I sort of wrote myself a program in 1957, I think, that these are the things that we were concerned with, almost making a list, making a table of concerns. And then I said, if I were going to make a work of art which satisfied these requirements, and among them were such items as it could be witty, it could be glamorous.
Young, transient, sexy, gimmicky, mass-produced, big business, and low cost as well. I mean, that's, I think, all part and parcel of what Richard Hamilton felt pop art should be.
The interesting thing about British pop art was that it came with a satiric edge to it at the same time. So it wasn't satirising so much America as satirising its own willingness to go belly up to America, you know. So it was sort of saying, here are these American cultural forms which we adore, and why not, because they are fantastic. But, you know, look at us, our willingness to abandon, you know, our own indigenous cultural forms in such a kind of shameless and craven way.
Through the 60s, Hamilton became the chronicler of swinging London, with an unerring eye for the iconic event.
Rolling Stone, Mick Jagger and Mayfair Art Gallery director Robert Fraser were handcuffed yesterday during journeys between Lewes Prison and the Chichester Court.
The newspaper cutting was shown to me by my girlfriend, and I was very impressed by it as a photograph. It seemed to be a very powerful image altogether. On analysis, the photograph began to show all sorts of interest. It occurred to me that it was a flash photograph, for example, that something that I hadn't used before. And when I began to draw from it, I realized that I had to make very heavy shadows. The gesture of a hand over the face, Mick Jagger is holding his hand over his face and there's a heavy cast shadow underneath, seems like a gesture against the glare, not only the glare of a flash, but the glare of publicity. In fact, Mick Jagger is making this gesture simply to demonstrate the handcuffs to the press, but he's doing it in a very theatrical way.
Inspired by Hamilton and the excitement of the new pop culture, British art found a new confidence and energy. In 1961, a buzz gathered around the Young Contemporaries exhibition in London, a show dedicated to new work by British art students.
Answer: the Young Contemporaries exhibition at a London gallery. This exhibit is called Little Prince. Beyond telling you that, no comment. Next, Abstract Motive, a good title for a real puzzle in alabaster.
One of the artists grabbing attention in the exhibition was Peter Blake. The son of an electrician, Blake had made his living as a teacher since leaving the Royal College of Art. But it was a remarkable self-portrait that really thrust him into the public eye. Blake's painting took the traditional model of the grand self-portrait, recasting it for a new, more democratic age. A year later, the 29-year-old Blake appeared in a film directed by a young Ken Russell called Pop Goes the Easel for the BBC art series Monitor.
Good evening. Our programme tonight consists of one single film, that we've made about four young artists. They're photos who turn for their subject matter to the world of pop art, the world of the popular imagination, the world of film stars.